Hey there, guys. We're simply waiting a few more minutes because we know there are a lot of people, a lot of students who are running late. Apparently, PoliMi had a few issues with WebEx, so we're just going to give him a few more minutes to connect. But in the meantime, we'll keep playing some music and we'll be ready at 6:05.
Più lo dico, più ci credo, più sbaglio. 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 Il bello di quando sbaglio è la parte in cui dico non lo faccio più. Il bello di quando lo dico è che ci credo, è che ci credo. Il bello di quando sbaglio è la parte in cui dico non lo faccio più. Il bello di quando lo dico è che ci credo. Più lo dico, più ci credo, più sbaglio. 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 Poi mi consolo, mi dico va meglio. Ma come un idiota, di nuovo sbaglio. E lo sbaglio è credermi ancora, dunque poi riparto alla stessa maniera. Più lo dico, più ci credo, più sbaglio. 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 Più lo dico, più ci credo, più sbaglio.
Okay, we're live. Hello, everyone. Hold on. Okay, I just started recording the session. So welcome back, everyone. Today, we'll be hosting the second event for the Explore ML series. And for those who may not know me yet, I am Alejandro Ferrero, the DSC lead at Politecnico di Milano. And with me, as always, I have the rest of the core team members, behind the scenes, making sure that everything is working. Simone Staffa, Mario Merlo, and Gianluca Guarro. You can actually reach out to them either on the chat or on Telegram, even after the event. If you feel like, talking to us, you can do so on social media. We'll be really happy to hear some feedback and interact with you guys. So I just wanted to mention a few things about Monday's event, which was amazing. We beat all kinds of records. We had over 600 students live streaming the event at some point. And obviously, these numbers are unprecedented in the developer student clubs community. So I just wanted to thank everyone for your support, for your engagement, for your interest in the program, and also congratulate everyone because now you guys are part of the history of the DSC communities. One more thing about that, if anyone missed the event on Monday or maybe wants to brush up a little bit on certain parts, the recording is now available on our YouTube channel on the official DSC PoliMi channel, so you can go ahead and check it out as many times as you want. And other than that, let's just move on. Today we have a whole day packed with really good content, really interesting, and I know Jacopo has prepared a few, fun activities again. So hopefully everyone will find them enjoyable. Everything is about neural networks today. Hold on. Is everything okay? Can everyone hear me? Okay, seems like it. I don't know if Jacopo is actually connected. Okay, okay, because I was getting worried that you were still muted. But in any case, a lot of interesting stuff on neural networks. And at the end of the event, we'll present some things about the project and we'll explain everything that goes with it, including the submissions and a few details here and there. So enjoy it, and now I'm just gonna pass it along to Jacopo, who is our facilitator and main presenter. So Jacopo, all yours.
All right, good evening everyone. So let me see if this is all working. So can you hear me well? Maybe better than last time since I'm wearing my headphones today. Provide feedback, yes, all right. Then that is fantastic for sure. All right, it is actually quite thrilling to see that there are a lot of people joining also today, and I'm really happy about this, of course. And today we're gonna talk about a fantastic topic, which is neural networks. It's actually my favorite topic, to be honest. They're so fascinating, and I'm sure that you'll find them fascinating yourselves. So let me go ahead and share my screen for this introduction. And we will be also now doing a brief introduction until we wait for the other students to join. I've heard that there were some issues with Cisco, so I hope that people will join as we go. All right, so let's get started with the first question, and I would like you to use the chat here on Bevy, on this fantastic platform that hosts us. So my first question would be, can you please write one thing that you really liked about last lecture? So I don't know if you really liked the different kind of machine learning techniques that we presented, or you really enjoyed the polls on Telegram, or any other thing that you really liked about the session that we did just 2 days ago. Right, I see many people say polls, some people say techniques, the simplicity of the explanation, fantastic, that's it's actually really good. I'm happy that it was quite easy to follow along. Interactions, the videos, yes, the videos were actually quite interesting and well made. So yeah, they were actually fantastic. All right, the polls seems they really seem that they're winning. So yeah, the engagement, real examples, yes, the real examples. All right, the format was perfect. All right, somebody also enjoyed Quick Draw, and I'm sure all of you enjoyed Quick Draw, and you probably played with it also maybe other times. You can send it to your friends. It's actually quite nice to know how machine learning works only by drawing, just like also a child could be using that. It's a nice tool. All right, so today we'll be jumping into neural networks, which are very, very, very interesting and widely used thanks to the computational power that's becoming cheaper and cheaper nowadays. And technology also, of course, is progressing quite fast. So that's amazing if you think about it. I mean, there's a reason why they're called neural, right? And it refers, of course, to our brain, and because they actually simulate what happens through the nervous system, right? So before we dive into neural networks, and we will watch what will be the only video of today's session, and also let me tell you, today we won't have any polls, so I'm really sorry about that since you like them a lot. However, we will be having two hands-on activities which I'm sure that you will enjoy. So, and we're gonna try to build a very interesting data set. So I really need your collaboration this time, even more than last time. All right. So let me ask you another question to see if you were paying attention last time. So remember that we have five main machine learning techniques, right? We have classification, we have clustering, we have regression, we have sequence prediction, and style transfer, right? So if I'm referring to the problem of identifying an object in a photo, which of these five would I be using, right? So I'm trying to identify an object in a photo. Would it be classification? Would it be clustering? Would it be regression? Would it be sequence prediction or style transfer? So use the chat to just throw out your answer. Fantastic, I see that. I guess all of you answered classification, and that is indeed the correct answer. So it seems like this warm-up question was too easy. And some of you are saying it depends if you know what object you want to find. Yes, but I would like to expand on that. So please tell us why you think it depends also if you already know what kind of object you want to find. So use the chat, and we'll get back to that later because we will have a lot of time in which you guys will be doing an activity, and I'll be also answering some questions that are left behind. So, okay, I guess we can get started since we already have almost 400 people. So let's go ahead and get started. All right, so I'll ask Simone to play the first video for today. So I'll stop sharing my screen and he can take over.
Hi, I'm Nat.
And I'm Lo.
And this is our 20% project, where we go find out about different Google stuff we're curious about.
Last year, we got to make a documentary about how voice search works. And that was the first time we heard about something called machine learning.
Since then, we've been kind of fascinated by it.
So today, we're talking with Greg and Chris to learn more about it.
How would you describe machine learning to someone?
Well, there's a lot of problems that's really easy to solve with computers. Computers can go and like simulate how galaxies move and how
Hi, I'm Nat.
And I'm Lo.
And this is our 20% project, where we go find out about different Google stuff we're curious about.
Last year, we got to make a documentary about how voice search works. And that was the first time we heard about
This is our 20% project, where we go find out about different Google stuff we're curious about. Since then, we've been kind of fascinated by it.
So today, we're talking with Greg and Chris to learn more about it.
How would you describe machine learning to someone?
Well, there's a lot of problems that's really easy to solve with computers.
So computers can go and like simulate how galaxies move. Play all these videos with so many people on the platform. So we just shared the link on the chat. So if you go ahead and check it out yourselves, and then as we did yesterday, Jacopo will take it from there, ask you a few questions about it. We tried a different way this time, but obviously nothing really replaces, hosting this event in person. You have the link, so if you have any questions, just throw them in the chat and Jacopo will take right after.
Last year, we got to make a documentary about how voice search works. And that was the first time we heard about something called machine learning.
Since then, we've been kind of fascinated by it.
So today, we're talking with Greg and Chris to learn more about it.
How would you describe machine learning to someone?
Well, there's a lot of problems that's really easy to solve with computers. Computers can go and like simulate how galaxies move and how the courses of asteroids going and how close they're going to come to Earth. I could never hope to go and do that, but I can go and do this problem like recognizing that that's a tree, which is so much tremendously more difficult for a computer.
It doesn't feel like intelligence to us because it's so effortless as a human being to do it, but for a computer, it's actually really hard.
Because the real world is kind of messy and unpredictable at times. The strict logical rules that go into traditional programming just don't work.
Instead of going and writing programs that solve the problem, we write programs that learn to solve the problem from examples.
And it's this process of learning that allows them to improve over time and to actually be more clever than they would be if we wrote down a very rigid set of instructions for them to follow.
Machine learning is in so many different things that we use today that it's kind of like this invisible magic ingredient.
Phones with the ability to understand human speech.
Machine translation, email spam filters. When you go to the ATM and you give a check and it can read the handwriting.
Or a photos app that can automatically organize your photos based on the things that you like to take photos of. Like, here are all my mountain photos, here are all my food photos.
Here are all my dog photos.
Here are all my feet photos.
Everything from facial recognition to going and trying to recognize whether a particle is present in a particular collision at the LHC.
Which we'd just like to take a time out to say is that big tube in the ground over in Europe that smashes particles together at really fast speeds so that scientists can use that information to unlock the mysteries of the universe, among other cool things. Now back to our episode, because I am getting really dizzy doing this. Ooh. Ooh. So researchers and scientists are still experimenting and trying to find the best ways to teach computers how to learn. But a lot of the progress is coming from these algorithms that are based roughly on how the human brain works, and these are called artificial neural networks.
So an artificial neural network is something that it's a rough mathematical cartoon of how a biological neural network works. In a biological brain, we have individual cells called neurons. Each neuron looks at what its neighbors has to say and then decide what it wants to say. And in artificial neural networks, we have little mathematical functions. We put them in some organized structure, and then we say, okay, you guys all together, learn to do this task.
We have lots of neural nets that are really great at going and recognizing, you know, this is a cat, this is a dog, this is a frog, this is a mouse, this is a horse, this is a truck, and things like that.
So take, for example, trying to recognize what this is.
So it used to be that we were really proud if we could get a neural net with three layers to work. And it's recently that we've made a lot of progress on techniques that allow us to train much deeper neural nets.
And that's why this kind of machine learning is also called deep learning. A neuron in the bottom layer is just going to be looking at a tiny piece of the picture and making some computations about it. It doesn't understand anything about dogs specifically.
But what the neuron does understand is it says, I'm giving a signal that's useful for somebody who's giving a signal, who's giving a signal, who's giving a signal, who's giving a signal.
They're kind of able to unfurl this really high-dimensional knot and pull it apart and make it easier to go and separate different things that are close together on the surface from things that were tangled all together earlier.
But then at the top, we'll put two neurons, and these neurons look at the whole picture so far.
They're basically experts at making the final call, figuring out, oh, all the layers below me said these things, so I know that this is a dog, or at least I'm 92.4% sure that it's a dog, so it's basically a dog. And while there's been a whole lot of progress with teaching computers to learn, they're still much slower learners than we are, and they make mistakes that you and I wouldn't.
So what I was working on is sort of trying to find a way to go and look at a neural net and ask, what does the neural net think the platonic ideal of a cat is, or the platonic ideal of a dog, or anything it can classify as? And suddenly you can go and ask, you know, neural net, what do you think cat looks like? And you get a picture of a cat, or, you know, neural net, what do you think a barbell looks like? So these weights. And it goes and it shows you a picture not only of a barbell, but of an arm attached to a barbell. So the model thought
okay,
that
so it
the
seems
arm
was, like
it only learned what barbells were
most
looking at pictures of barbells. And
people are
held by
just writing in the chat
vectors.
That they're done.
And so,
let's allow
so
just another minute
was,
for
you know,
people to finish watching the video. And in the meantime, please start thinking of a word, a sentence, something that really captured your attention besides cats and dogs, for sure.
Get it.
I don't know, was it just the word mural, was it the word network, or anything else that really captured your attention? Or start throwing out some questions.
The more you describe this, the more I'm amazed by human beings.
Yeah.
The effect is like, wow, human beings are really amazing.
We're really amazing learning machines.
All right, so let's jump back into this. So I'll be sharing my screen again. All right, here it is. Fantastic. So again, all right, here we are. All right, so welcome back. And I really hope that you enjoyed the video that we had for today. That's gonna be the only video that we will be watching in today's session. That, as I already said, is going to be quite a lot of hands-on activities, right? But first, let's try to understand a little better what a neural network is, because this is a word that is pronounced quite a lot when we talk about machine learning and especially about deep learning, which I see most of you put as a word that really inspired them while watching this video. And so let's try also to understand better what is the difference between machine learning and deep learning, because I think that during the last session, maybe we went over it quite fast and it wasn't that clear to many of you. So let's try to do this. So first of all, let me try to gather also some insight from what you wrote in the chat. So there's Robert who's saying, I'm just intrigued by how a bunch of mathematical functions eventually can recognize a cat. And Robert, let me tell you, I'm also quite amazed by what neural networks can do. Right. Then let's see what else we've got here. The structure of the networks, the fact that each part considers only a single piece individually, and that is kind of true. It's not really a single piece. We would say a single feature. Yes, fantastic. Let's see, what else? Humans are better learning machines. Maybe, define better. All right. I also see a very long comment by Federico, let me read it out. If we as humans start learning since we are little babies, it's obvious that this process takes time for a machine that starts from scratch. That's my comment, and I'm amazed, just this. Maybe in the near future, a machine will be able to understand better how to learn based on past learning experiences, just theory. Yes, that's very interesting. Thanks for your comment, Federico, and we can dive into that later while the others are doing the hands-on activity anyway. All right, so what really is a neural network? Well, in the end, as Robert was saying, a neural network is just a mathematical function. However, we know that mathematical functions are not all quite simple, right? It's not always 2 + 2. And so as you may see also in the slide, we have this complex network of, and we call them nodes, that are interconnected, right? And they start on the left from an input that can be an image, or it can be text, can be any sort of data. And this input goes through a series of neurons, and then it outputs some sort of label, right? Some sort of measure, something that you would like. And so through a neural network, you can actually do everything that we were also seeing before. So you can implement classification, and you can implement clustering, you can implement regression, sequence prediction. You can implement like a lot of machine learning techniques. So a neural network is mostly a mean, right? It's a way to perform some specific machine learning task. Okay, this is really important. A neural network is not a machine learning technique. We can call it a machine learning mean, right? All right. So I hope that's clear. And let me also take a moment to define what labeled data means, right? Because maybe some of you are wondering what is the difference between labeled photos and unlabeled photos. So there are two kinds of learning. We have supervised learning and unsupervised learning. So in supervised learning, what we do is we have data points that are in our data set, which are labeled. And that means that we have both the input and the output. For instance, if you look at the first picture, that's a cat, right? And you are telling your neural network, this is a cat. So this is the image, and this image represents a cat. And you can do the same with the second image. This is the image, and it is a dog. So you're already telling the network, this image is a dog. Now you may be wondering, so if you already know that that's a dog, why are you then training the network and doing all of this complex stuff? Well, of course, you're doing that because you would like to feed the network with another image that you don't know if it refers to a cat or a dog, and then let the network tell you if it's a cat or a dog, right? Of course, recognizing and distinguishing between a cat and a dog is quite easy for us humans, but it's not as easy to identify, for instance, cancer, right, in a Rx. So that's the first explanation I wanted to give. And of course, unsupervised learning is when you do not provide the network with labels, right? So that's, of course, a more difficult task. Anyway, so let's move on because we have a lot to cover today, and I really want to move forward. And you can drop all your questions in the chat, and we will be collecting them and then answer them while the others are doing the hands-on activity. So to make it simple, we have an input, right? And we have our activation function, which is very important for the neuron. So in accordance to the answer, right? So relatively to the answer to the question asked by the activation function, we can kind of explain it this way, we will decide whether to activate the neuron or not to activate the neuron, right? So that should be quite easy to understand, right? Let's make an example. So if as input we get the number 5, then if our activation function is less than 10, then since as input we have 5, then yes, we will be activating the neuron. If our input was like 11, then we would not be activating the neuron. Okay, so it kind of works like this. And let's make another example to make it clear. So for instance, look at the image in the on the slide. In this case, the activation function has a curve. And the answer for this case is no. And so you will not be activating the neuron. This is just another example. So you see the six. The six does have a curve, and then you will activate the neuron. All right. So if everything is clear by now, and I know you might have like lots and lots of questions, but really try to bear with me because it's not easy to understand. And if we dive deeper into more complex questions, then you might not really get the hold of everything straight away. And so let's do that in later. So we consider now two important activation functions that are widely used for two problems that we already discussed in our previous session. So among those classification, clustering, regression, and whatever. So the first one is the sigmoid activation function, right? And you can see it is 1 over 1 plus e to the minus x. And you can also see the plotted version of the function. And what it does is that it takes a value, x, and it outputs a value that is between 0 and 1. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. So among all of the methods that we were looking at the last time, what method do you think sigmoid is used for? Do you think it's used for style transfer or sequence prediction or regression, clustering, classification? So please answer in the chat. And let me answer a question that I see here. So every neuron has a specific function. Yes, you can have different activation functions for every neuron. What usually happens is that you have different activation functions for every layer of neurons. And we will see what a layer of neurons is. All right, so most of you answered correctly. It is indeed a classification, right? So what we're trying to do here is we're trying to map a value to another value that is between 0 and 1. So some of you might have been confused by this and said regression. Right, because you thought about what I said last time. I said if it's outputting a value, then for sure that's a regression, right? However, since it is a mathematical function, we can't really output a discrete value, which could be like cat or dog, right? We need some sort of numbers here, right? And so also to tackle the classification problem, then we definitely want to use a function. And as you may see, only some values, which are the ones very close to zero, are values which assume values in between zero and one, like in the middle. Most of the other values just assume either zero or close to zero and very close to one, right? So in this case, we can interpret this as, or we can actually use this as a way to classify our data. Does it belong to class 0 or does it belong to class 1? So if the number outputted by the sigmoid function is very close to 0, then we're quite sure that the class is 0. And if the number outputted is 1, then we're quite sure that the class is 1. So I really hope that this is clear, and some of you said, because we want a range that can be interpreted as probability, and that's exactly the case for the sigmoid function, right? We would like to know if it belongs to one class or the other class, and that kind of also refers to probability in the sense that the closer it is to one, then the more sure we are that it belongs to to a certain class, and more the closer it is to zero, the more sure we are it belongs to class zero, right? So that's the first activation function. And of course, some of you are wondering what happens first off if we get a number that is like 0.5. And of course, that can happen. Well, in that case, you simply say that you don't know. Let's make an example. So let's say you train a network to identify cats and dogs, right? But you feed it with the picture of, I don't know, a bird, right? So what do you expect the network to say? Do you expect it to say zero, or do you expect it to say one? Right, so I'm not really aware of birds that look like cats or dogs. So if you are aware of them, please post the picture on the Telegram group. That would be quite funny, but don't spam, please. And so the network would be quite unsure on what to do, right? And so it will probably output a number that is just between zero and one, and it's definitely not zero and not one, right? Another question that some of you asked is, what if we have more than two classes? And of course, that's a very important question. Well, then there's another function to do that. So I don't really recall the name right now, but, and some of you will probably be able to help me, just don't recall the name, but there is another function to do that also. I think it's the softmax, if I don't go wrong. Yes, exactly. Some of you also said that in the chat. Fantastic. So congratulations, Andrea and Fabrizio. It is indeed the softmax function, and that function allows you to predict more classes, right? So that's the multi-class classification problem. All right, so if all of this is clear, and I know you have like a lot of questions, so please just throw them there and we'll eventually answer them. Let's move on to the ReLU. The ReLU, that is rectified linear unit, is a function defined as the maximum between zero and x. So it pretty much just takes x, and if x is negative, then it brings it to zero. If it's positive, it just leaves it as it is, right? So it's one of the most simple functions ever. You may be wondering, so why don't we like negative values? And that is a very interesting question, which we won't dive deep into today, but it refers to the gradient descent, vanishing gradient problem. So we won't be diving deep into that, but just trust me, the rectified linear unit is a very, very, very commonly used function to perform a certain task that I will be asking you. So which task do you believe that we can use the ReLU for? Is it, again, classification? Is it clustering? Is it regression or sequence prediction, style transfer? And of course, also in this case, we have that the function outputs a number. However, the number is not limited, right? So just goes to infinity, and it captures a linear relation. So I see that most of you answered regression. That is indeed the right answer. So fantastic, regression is actually the task in which you want to find the linear relationship between variables. That is exactly it. You would be using the ReLU in most of the cases for regression. There's also variants of the ReLU. There's like the leaky ReLU or other kind of ReLUs that you might need to use in case your specific problem performs better with different ReLUs. So being like let's call it a neural network engineer, not even a machine learning engineer, right? And this also brings me back to what we were saying before. I want to explain better the difference between machine learning and deep learning. So let's say you are a deep learning engineer. So you're dealing with neural networks. Your main activities will not only be to gather the data, which is kind of also the job of a data engineer, right? Data scientists and data engineers, they gather data, they clean data, they make sure data is ready to perform other tasks. And data scientists themselves, like I do, they also perform the later steps. However, let's say that specifically a deep learning engineer, all day they would just understand what the best activation functions are for their network. What is the number of neurons they shall be using? What is the number of layers they shall be using? How to hyperparameter tune the network? That is the essential job of a deep learning engineer. Exactly, and I see Andrea in the chat who said parameter tuning. Exactly, that is one of the most important things, which is also very hard to do. Anyway, all right, so I hope this was clear enough. And we can visually see now how a neural network behaves in reality and how all the neurons, the role of the neurons in the network, right? So the first image that we get is the input, right, image. So a dog and a cat. And so we see how the neurons in the middle are trying to capture the features of the image, right? So they all refer to a different piece or feature of the input image, right? And then they just keep transferring the knowledge to other neurons in the network. And once they're done, they're able to classify, in this case, the image correctly, right? So I hope there are no big questions on this, also because we're gonna do the hands-on activity in a second. And in that activity, you will be seeing the network in action, right? Okay, so before explaining the activity, this will be part of the activity, let me take a minute to explain the difference between machine learning and deep learning further. So in machine learning, what you do is that you feed your architecture, we can't really call it network, with features, right? So you already tell the network, these are the features that I would like you to consider. And so the features may be, for instance, like the, I don't know, if you're considering cats and dogs, then you will have like the size of the ears or the size of the mouth or the color or, I don't know, many other features. So if you feed, if you tell the network, these are the features I want you to consider, then you're doing machine learning. If, however, you're not telling the network about the features to consider, and the network is able to capture the features by itself, and that is the case for neural networks when you do not specify the features, as pretty much we're doing in also in the hands-on activity. So you just feed the image. This is the image. This is the bit representation of the image. Go ahead and do whatever you want with it. I don't care. You want to consider the size of the ears? Go ahead. You want to consider their teeth? Go ahead. You want to consider their name? Not my problem. It's your problem, Mr. Neural Network, right? So I hope this is clear. Machine learning may also be using neural networks, but you're really specifying the features. Deep learning is not using the features, okay? All right, so in this case, we're gonna do machine learning on a neural network. So we will be telling the network which features to consider, and we will be having our network here, right? As you may see, you can select the features that you would like to provide the network with. You can select the number of neurons, and as some of you said, all the neurons are connected to each other. That is actually correct. That is a connected neural network, right? You see every neuron is connected to all of them. Fantastic. So you see the networks here, and you can also add other layers. Of course, as you add layers, you will increase the complexity of the network. So that could be good if you're dealing with a very complex problem. However, it could be really bad, but really, really bad if you're dealing with a simple problem and you have very little data, because it will cause overfitting. So what is really overfitting? Overfitting happens when your network performs really, really well on all of the data that you provided with at the beginning, during the training phase. So with the labeled data mostly, right? So if you provide a neural network with labeled data and you want it to perform fantastically on that data, then it might happen that, and it will probably happen, that the network will be very good with that data, but it will be very, very, very bad with new data. And that is the case, of course, of overfitting. It could also happen the opposite, that is underfitting. So if you are using a network that is very, very simple and it is not able to capture the features of your complex problem, then your results will be very poor. Okay, so let's move on so we can jump into the hands-on activity. The output you may see shows you the test loss and the training loss. And as it is a loss, we won't really see what loss is, but it's a number that we want to keep very low, right? So as close to zero as possible. However, we don't want the training loss to be very low, because otherwise we would incur into overfitting. We want the test loss to be very low. All right, so in this case, the problem shown, it's a classification problem, as you may have guessed. And the objective will be to make a neural network able to capture the features of this set of points, right? So again, you will be able to choose which features you would like to include, to choose the number of neurons and the number of hidden layers, and then you will see the output. So let's actually jump into this. And before clicking on the link, which I also ask the core team members to post in the chat and on Telegram, let's actually take a second to explain what you will be doing. So you will be going through three exercises, because we don't have time to go through all of them. So please follow what we will be posting. So in the first exercise, complete only tasks 1 through 3, and you can just go ahead later tonight or tomorrow and complete all of the tasks. Of course, this is open anytime, anywhere, but please let's take 25 minutes maximum to complete the whole hands-on activity so we can jump into the next one later. So please go ahead and by yourself. In the meantime, I will just be answering some questions, gathering some doubts. So you can just go ahead and play with the link. Again, this is the link, which I see you guys already posted it. Let me see. Yeah, I'll be posting it, it's fine. Copy link. Here it is. Let me post it also on Telegram. All right, fantastic. So you can go ahead and play. In the meantime, I'll be answering some questions. So if you feel like you want some answers, you just want to hang around, and we'll also be walking through maybe one of them together later. But first, let me get some time to answer some questions. All right. And whoever wants to take a break, go ahead and take a break. All right. All right. Let me start answering some questions. Let me see. All right, so Alex is asking, an algorithm that learns how to play a game, is deep learning? Well, that is a good question. Of course, it could be. You just said an algorithm, Alex. So, I mean, which algorithm, right? But you can definitely implement a neural network which is able to learn a game strategy. That is exactly what I developed during my thesis at Politecnico, so that question is actually quite interesting to me. So if you, I'm not sure how confident you are with the field of game theory, but to make it quite easy, you can consider the fact that in a game, as you are considering an artificial intelligence, but actually you can also refer this to humans, you have a set of actions, right? So in whichever state you are, you have a set of actions. For instance, right now, I could stop talking, and of course, the session will become very boring, I hope. and you want to find a strategy, right, over all the possible actions that you have. So for instance, in this case, I will just keep talking and answer your questions because I really want this session to go as better as possible, right? So again, a game is based on a strategy. And the strategy is a probability distribution over the possible actions. So for instance, if you have action A and action B, then you would be, I don't know, doing action A with 50% probability and action B with 50%, or action A with 30% and action B with 70%. Or maybe you never want to do action B, like in this case, I would never decide to stop talking. And so that would be 100% and zero. And so if you imagine there are many actions, that becomes a regression problem in which your output is limited between 0 and 1. And you would like to learn the probability with which your agent takes a certain action. And so in order to do that, you could employ deep learning and you could employ neural networks. That's exactly what I did for my thesis, which is based off of course, much more important works in the field. And you can definitely go ahead and use neural networks to estimate the strategy, right? All right, anyway, I won't dive deeper into that, but if anybody is interested into this field, make sure you take the game theory class, the autonomous agents and multi-agents class, the machine learning class, of course, the soft computing class is also quite important, right? All of these classes are important in general for machine learning, but specifically for this topic. And please let me know if you have any other questions on this. All right, let me see other questions. Let me jump to other questions. And also, if you have any questions on the exercise that we're doing, please feel free to ask me. However, there are also answers in the application, so you can go ahead and look at them. They're probably way more detailed than what I could say. Anyway, so some of you is asking to explain a second overfitting and underfitting again, right? If I'm not wrong, okay. So again, Martina, yes, overfitting and underfitting. Let me go back to this. So, and I hope you're there. So please say, tell me if you're there. All right, anyway, so overfitting happens. Yeah, fantastic. Okay, so overfitting happens when your network is very complex and your network trains for so long that it learns how to correctly perform the task with like 100% accuracy, right? With a very high accuracy. So when the training loss is very low. So please let me know if this was clear or if, again, I need to explain this again, perhaps with some examples. All right, clear. So the opposite is instead underfitting. And that happens when your network is too simple, right? And you're not able to capture the relationship between the variables that you're considering, that the input and the output, right? So we have that in this case, for instance, you have the output, right? And if you see here on the slides, the output is non-linear, right? This means that there is, and this also answers the question that Julia is asking right now. So so you may see that the output here is non-linear, right? Because what does it mean for the output to be linear? It means that in the case of classification, well, it means that you can take a line, right? You can take a line and place the line over your data set and almost, at least, perfectly separate the two sets, right? So the orange one and the blue one. So it is quite obvious that in this case, it is impossible if you only, right, if you only consider a single line. And that answers the question that I said ReLU would, is a non-linear, sorry, is a, ReLU is linear in the sense that the relationship X is linear. That's what I meant before. But if you combine several ReLUs, then you can capture non-linearities. And you would need at least three neurons to do that, if I don't go wrong. And so in order to capture non-linearities, such as the case of the output, you need more than two neurons to do that. And you can dive deeper yourself with the XOR example, right? So exclusive OR. And there, it's also a very nice exercise that they also let us do during the machine learning course at Politecnico. They let you, actually, maybe it is a soft computing course, if I don't know, well, probably both. Anyway, they let you try to implement the network on paper and to actually update the network and the activation function yourself. Right, it is, well, not the activation function, sorry, the weights of the network, and we will I'll be describing the weights also in a second for all of you who is here. Okay, so I hope Julia and Martina this cleared a little bit your questions, and this is very hard, and it's not easy to answer all of this in like in a session, also considering that you're very new, I assume, on the topic, so I'll try to be as clear as possible. Anyway, let's move on. So, all right, so Sebastiano Vittoria is asking, how can I understand, let me see, how can I understand if my model is learning any non-linearities? How can I read the graph? So which graph are you referring to? Because you, if you're referring to this, then you can see the features that your network is learning just by looking at this, right? You see that in this case, it is learning these features, right? So I hope that kind of answered Sebastiano's question. Yes, okay. Yeah, so that's how you would do, and I would invite you, as the also the exercise does, to try adding other features and see what happens. All right. Let's see other questions. Okay. The question from Nima is, of course, one of the most important questions when it comes to deep learning engineering, right? So neural network engineering, how to decide for the number of hidden layers and the number of neurons. And actually, again, Nima, if you walk through the explanation provided by the application itself, then you can definitely hear more detailed answers. What I will tell you is it's really a matter of trying it out, right? So the number of hidden layers depends really on the application and on the complexity of your domain. So what is usually done is that you try to have, at least 3 or 4 hidden layers, right? And the number of neurons for each hidden layer shouldn't be fixed. So you don't really want like a rectangle, right? As a network, you want something that looks a little bit like this. See, where it starts quite big, so it explores, and then it converges to something, right? However, this may not always be the case, because for instance, it could happen that the problem that you're looking at does not require much complexity, or it requires more neurons, but less hidden layers. The problem with hidden layers is the fact that they do define the depth of the network. And that is why we call it deep learning, because the network is deep and each level is actually referred to as the depth, right? And of course they're hidden because we consider the input and then the output and everything that is in between is hidden, right? So is hidden to who will be using the network. That is also why we call it a black box methodology, right? Because you don't really understand what is happening inside. And that's also quite hard for neural network junior, let's say, engineers, because you're like, okay, well, I put a ReLU, I put like 6 neurons, 5 hidden layers, and yeah, it works. But of course, there are some drawbacks when you increase the complexity of your network, when you increase the depth of your network. For instance, the deeper it is, the easier it is to have the vanishing gradient problem, which won't let your network learn. You can do whatever you want, but if you have a vanishing gradient problem, and I'm not going to explain what that is, but because that's quite intermediate, I would say, then won't really go anywhere. So you kind of want to try out several different configurations. And there are methods to do that also. It's pretty much about searching. So you want to try out different configurations until you get the best one, okay? All right, so let's also allow another, 10 minutes for people to go ahead and finish these exercises. Go ahead and play with the other exercises. We have the neural net initialization. We suggest to do tasks 1 and 2, and also the neural net spiral. Now, if we were in a in-presence event, we would be sharing some thoughts also with the class. So you would be sharing something, but in this case, we can only use the chat. All right, let me go ahead and answer some more questions. All right, so I see one question is, what is the purpose of this exercise? Well, the purpose of this exercise is to provide you with hands-on experience on neural networks, without having to code them out. Because trust me, coding out a neural network is very, very easy. We have a lot of frameworks such as TensorFlow, PyTorch, or scikit-learn. They're all mainly for Python, but there are also other languages you may use them with. And they're really easy. Like, to add a hidden layer to a neural network is literally one line of code in TensorFlow. So that's quite easy. I mean, any computer scientist or any engineer can do that. And writing like an actual neural network is probably like 5 or 6 lines of code. So that's quite easy to do, right? From a technical perspective. So the purpose of this exercise, and I wanted to make this clear also if you were wondering about the purpose of the neural network in the site. The purpose of this exercise is to let you understand why you are doing something, why you are increasing the number of neurons, why you're considering some certain features. And trust me, I have been a student at Politecnico, right, until a month ago. And I've taken the machine learning class, I've taken the soft computing class, I've taken any sort of AI class. I've also taken the deep learning class when it was a PhD only class. And nobody will ever explain as practically as this exercise what features really mean, how neurons really behave. Trust me, like, I followed each lesson, and I hope that they've changed in the last year. But if you understand the tasks that we're doing in these two sessions, then you will have a much easier life during the courses and in general for your understanding of neural networks and deep learning. So let me go ahead and answer the other question. So Butterbean, that's your name in the chat, you were asking about the purpose of the neural network in the site, right? So the purpose of the neural network is to capture the relationship that there is in the image that you may see here. So as you see it in this case, for instance, you want to learn that there is this sort of relationship in which points in the upper left and the lower right are orange, and points in the upper right and lower left are blue. And so if you actually go on the website, let me actually do that a second and then we can move on. If you actually go here, if I don't go wrong, you may see that, let me zoom in, okay. If you show the test data, right, you see that the test data, which is the one that appears, is actually located where you would expect it to be, right? So for instance, these orange dots are here because we have learned as humans, not as the computer, that the orange dots should be here, right? So if we go ahead and try this exercise out, so if we just leave it like this, let's see what happens. So, and a good number of epochs is about 1,000, but you may see that this simple network is not able to capture the relationship, right, between the points in the output. This is, of course, a classification problem, right, if this is not clear. So also you're asking what the colors mean, and they are two classes. And so we want to make this a little more complex, right? So for instance, let's try to add another neuron and see what happens. So again, as I've said before, it is quite hard to learn, almost impossible to learn a non-linear relationship if you only have two neurons and your activation also is linear, right? Linear is simply x. So let's go ahead and play with the ReLU. Right. ReLU is trying, as you may see, with only two neurons to separate the points. However, it's not performing that well, right? Let's now try to add another neuron. So theoretically, now if we add another neuron, we should be able exactly to get quite nice performances. You see, the test loss and the training loss are going down, and that's fantastic. So you will never get to zero in this case. I mean, you could potentially overfit if you wanted to. So you could get your training loss to zero quite easily. However, your test loss will be very bad, right? So let's see, yeah, you can read here the reason about the XOR, right? All right, so we also have other exercises and we're running a little late, so let's perhaps go ahead and answer a couple more questions, and I can ask also the core team if they can tell on the Telegram chat that we are getting back in 5 minutes or so. Yeah, 5 minutes, I would say. So I can answer another couple questions and ask everybody to be back in 5 minutes so we can jump into our final hands-on activity. All right, so a lot of you are asking what regularization stands for, and yeah, you probably have seen this over here, right? So regularization and the regularization rate is a way to penalize the network for its complexity. And so if it is used when you have quite a complex network, because your problem is quite complex, right? So if your problem is complex, you do want a complex network, that is for sure. However, you do not want the network to have weights such that the complexity is even more. And if that happens, then your network will specify quite well, or specialize, sorry, quite well on the training task or the training data, and resulting, of course, in overfitting. So you don't want that. So regularization, and there's a lot around that, weight decay and blah, 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 a lot of techniques. You can use it to penalize your network for complexity, right? So if you start adding like a lot of neurons and a lot of hidden layers, then your network for sure will be quite complex, right? And it will overfit. See, like in this case, of course, the more complex it is, the more time in terms of epochs it will take for the network to train, right? And you see that, well, in this case, the problem is quite easy in reality. And so it still performs quite well also without regularization, right? We could also try to add regularization, but really I would like you to try it yourself and understand why things happen. That is why I wanted you to do this by yourself and come up with questions. You can try this one, the one with the spiral. This one is a very nice exercise. I really suggest you to walk over this and read the answers to the tasks and also look at the video. Some of you is asking what's the noise here in the data. Well, the noise is simply how good your data is, right? So if we put the noise to zero, you can definitely go ahead and perfectly learn this distribution of points, right? So let's go back and like a simpler network here. You can do something like this with ReLU. So you see, if you also output the test data, in this case, you would get simply the points where you expect them. And it's quite easy to learn this. So you will probably get to zero loss. Let me try to do this. Why isn't this working well? No, the neurons must be two if I don't go wrong. and separating them like this. Yeah, here it is. So I was missing a simple neuron. Sorry about that. All right. So yeah, because the regions are you have to consider these regions. So you see how the training loss is going to zero, and also the test loss is going down. And this doesn't mean overfitting. It just means that you have no noise. Of course, if you increase the noise, then all your points are not really fantastic. So you need a more complex model to learn all of this quite well, but at the same time, you don't want to over to make your model quite complex, because you want to generalize, as one of you were saying before. So again, the batch size, it's quite an interesting question, is the size of the data that you are feeding the network with while training. So that's what it is. So a larger batch size will require more time to train, if I don't go wrong. Right, the learning rate is a number that you, first of all, you want to keep quite low, so you don't want like a learning rate of 10. And it is a number that tells the network how much they should forget about the past and learn about the future. Right. So if you have a very high learning rate, then you are not quite sure about yourself, so you're not very confident. If you have a high learning rate, then you really believe in the future. All right, so I guess we can stop with, you have a lot of questions, and I was truly expecting this. And Alejandro, I think that this is fantastic, really. And I see the, all the participants are very interested. So I guess that's fantastic. If you wanna break in a second, and Also tell our students that they will have to bear with us for all of this event, because we will be presenting the project, right? The task that they will have to do at the end of the of this event. So do not leave it, even if you're hungry.
That's right. That's right, Jacopo. I mean, this is amazing stuff, and the fact that they have so many questions just means that obviously they're interested, because all this content is just unreal. But it's going to be very useful later on, especially because, as Jacopo said, we're going to be presenting details and everything that goes into the project that some of you may be interested in completing. So we'll give out all those details at the end of this presentation on neural networks, because that way everyone will have all the tools and all the required knowledge to, you know, actually put them to practice or kind of like brainstorm on them. So please sit tight, still bear with us for a little bit longer. We know that these events are, you know, kind of hard to estimate, because everyone has a lot of questions, but we are going to try to go through everything as quickly and as thoroughly as possible. And at the end, we'll present that part about the projects. Okay. Does that sound good?
Sounds good to me. All right. So welcome back. I really hope that you had fun experimenting with the visual tool. I think it's fantastic. I mean, whoever built that, not from a technical side, but from a design, from a user experience, I think that's just fantastic. So do we have actually anyone that is not an engineer here? Like architects or designers or mathematicians or... I don't know, anything that is not engineering. I wouldn't be expecting. I'm a designer, fantastic. That's fantastic to hear, Camilla. I'm really glad that somebody that is not an engineer is also very interested in this. I think it's very interesting to have also people not from engineering. So Camilla, what do you think about this application? Did you try it out? Was it easy to use? What do you think? So please tell us about it on the chat. In the meantime, I will also ask you to share, again, just one thought or one sentence about the exercise that we just did, how you feel right now. Do you feel empowered, or do you feel like very bored? How do you feel? How do you feel? Do you feel like you would like more hands-on experience? You would like to code, or do you think that this it's good for now? Do you feel like you're totally lost, or you have like thousands of questions? And it's okay to be confused. It's very okay to be confused. All right, so we see the first answers. So first, Camila said it's great to dive into this world. So we're really happy that how are you feeling this way, Camila? And to be honest, I'm also happy that people are feeling confused, because if you feel like you understood everything, then perhaps you haven't, right? It's very hard. It's not a very easy topic. We're not doing 2+2. And this is probably, neural networks are very hard. Neural networks are not easy, even though they are a black box, right? So you feed them with data and they work magically, but they work well only if you set the right parameters, the right activation functions, the right number of neurons, the right number of hidden layers. What else? If you have identified the problem correctly, actually, right? So trust me, it's not easy. And a question that once a person asked me was, just a friend of mine, but he was saying, do you think neural networks can have bugs, like in code? And I said, well, they won't really have bugs in the sense of, like, of course, if you write the code wrong, then you get into a bug, but they can perform well, or they can perform really poorly, right? And so I would call poor performance like a bug, right? All right, so fantastic. So yes, it might have been a little too complex, this exercise, for starters especially, but I think it was the right amount of complexity for most of you. So I'm really happy that we still have almost 400 people in this event. And again, I really hope that some of you will get, again, this fantastic t-shirt, because it's actually quite nice and we're quite proud to be part of the Developer Students Club. All right, let's move into a very hard task, which is not actually that hard. I just need your collaboration. So if you're still there, please type anything on your keyboard, like anything, literally. And so if you're still there, please let me know. Okay, anything, exactly. Fantastic. I really like the spirit here. Okay, so you're still here. Great. All right, so again, as Mario was saying before, please go ahead and download Google Drive, the Google Drive application, if you don't have it yet, on your smartphone. So take out your smartphones and download the Google Drive application. Shouldn't take that long. And do not go on this link, because we will be doing that together, right? And you can go ahead and play with it later on today or tomorrow, but let's try to do this together. All right, so while we wait that everybody downloads the app, that shouldn't take long, but anyway, I wanted to tell you that one of the most important things when it comes to engineering, when it comes to working, when it comes to researching, is having a good network of people, right? Having friends, having a connection with somebody who is very skilled, having, connections with others is truly important. Because did it ever happen to you that while you were explaining a problem that you had to somebody, then you would find a solution by just explaining them the problem, and they would be like, why did you come to me if you just answered yourself? And that's actually interesting. Has it ever happened to you? And it is very important. It's crucial to have a good network. And why it is such? Because each one of us is specialized, or will be specialized, in one precise thing, right? There is not going to be the perfect machine learning engineer. There's not going to be the perfect neural network engineer, right? each one of us will be specified in one particular topic, right? As professors are also, right? Don't expect professors to know everything about everything. So first off, let's go ahead and do this thing. So I'm sure most of you have LinkedIn, which is the most important social network for working and connecting with peers at a professional level. And exactly, Alex, I was referring to the rubber duck when you're talking about the friend that you explain things to. And so let's first do this. So scroll the chat and find, I don't know, 5 people, 10 people, or even more, as many as you want, and just connect with them on LinkedIn or on Facebook or on whatever other social network that you wish. And if you don't want to do this, that's totally fine, of course, and you can just, or Reddit or whatever other social network. And if you don't want to do this, then just ignore the friend's request. So also, please connect with me because I really want to know where you will be in a few years' time. If I think about myself like 2 years ago, I would have never thought I would have been here now explaining machine learning to almost 400 people today and more than 600 last session, and even more if you think about all of the people that will be watching this fantastic event, right? So please go ahead and connect with people. Connect, because that's the most important thing, right? So fantastic. All right, so by now, I really think that all of you have downloaded the Google Drive application, which, I mean, you probably already have it on your phone. Anyway, let's do this. So I will ask Mario to post the message for this activity on our groups so that we also can read it together, right? It's very easy. So in order to play with this application, we will first be building a data set, right? So in order to do this, we need your help because we don't have any images yet. And we want to create our own images. So if you're ready, right? And yes, Mario already posted the message on Telegram and he'll be posting it also on here in the chat. Go ahead and read with me the description. It's very important that you follow the instructions, right? Otherwise, what happens with dirty data? Our network will be we'll have a performance that is very, very poor. All right. So please, let's take this quite seriously because it's a nice activity, it's fun, but we really need your help. All right, so we will be training a neural network classification model with our homemade dataset. And I think that's fantastic, right? We'll be using images of our hands in a thumbs up and thumbs down position. So thumbs up, and it could be in any orientation. Actually, the more variants we have, the better it will perform, right? Even though it would be better if the background was not very noisy, right? Because if we have a noisy background, the complexity will increase, right? And so it is important also for this to work that the images are in JPEG format. So if you have an iPhone, please make sure to go to settings, camera, formats, and choose most compatible. Whereas on Android, it should be JPEG by default. And take like 5 or 6 photos just with your cell phone of your thumb, like 5 thumbs up, right? And maybe change the orientation, don't take 5 equal, and 5 with your thumbs down, right? And once you did this, I would like you to upload them to the Google Drive folders that we set up. So I hope those are still working, they should still be working. So go ahead and upload, of course, the images with your thumbs up in the up folder, and the images which are thumbs down in the down folder. Otherwise, our network will be not performing well. So I'll be waiting for your submissions. Let me go ahead and see where I have them open. Right-handed selection bias? No. Why? No, I guess they're just specular, so it also depends on if the camera flips the image or not. So I don't know. I wouldn't say we're going to incur into that problem. Right. And I chose the hand because it's just the most normal thing that we have. And we all, I hope, it's quite easy to gather, right? So while you're doing this, let me go ahead and check how this is all going. Right, so, yeah, I see that the, fantastic, they look fine to me, the ones in the down folder, and let's see the ones in the up, and make sure that you can see the full thumb, right? Because what is the feature that we want to capture, right? The thing is, if we took photos that are only like this, then if we shift and we take photos only like this, what about this? Would it be up or down? Well, it could be down because it would be recognizing this part of the hand and not the tip. So we really want all kinds of our orientations. And please go ahead and keep uploading your pictures. We really need pictures of your hands. Fantastic. I really love the collaboration, to be honest. Like, it is fantastic to be working with you guys. I feel like I'm surrounded by very serious people. So thank you a lot for this. All right. So I'll allow just a couple more minutes for you to upload the thumbs up and thumbs down. And of course, as Alejandro pointed out on Telegram, make sure you follow the DSC social media. So you will, and this is also very crucial because you'll be able to find people that are younger than you or older than you, maybe are already working somewhere you would like to work, and you would like to just connect with them and ask a question. Like, sincerely, it is quite easy to just drop a message and say, hey, would you be available for, I don't know, 30 minutes conversation? And if they don't want to answer you, then they will just ignore your message, and that's totally fine. I mean, we all are busy, have other things to think about, but in the best case, they will just answer you, and you'll have a nice conversation and meet somebody new, right? So there's nothing wrong with sending a heads up message. It's just like, hey, can we just talk for half an hour? And I think this is also very important if you're looking for like, career advice or technical advice on something, or if you're like your bachelor's and you're wondering, should I go ahead and go for the cybersecurity track, or should I go ahead and go for, I don't know, the AI and machine learning track, right? So, all right, so see that most of the pictures uploaded are quite nice. And thanks really again for making this possible. So let's go ahead and uploading all of this. I see, and also please take a moment to follow everybody that just posted their Instagram and LinkedIn link. And if you can't do this right now because you're following the session, just go ahead and do it later, because as I said, it is just fantastic to see such a community. It's so many of them, so many of us. We're creating so many connections. Actually, if one of you who really likes mathematics wants to calculate the number of combinations that we're creating, that's totally fine, and post your answer in the chat. Let me go ahead assuming that all 360 of us are sharing and are connecting. All right, so let's upload the images. So we'll be importing the images from Google Drive. Right. So here they are. So class one is up. I'll be selecting all of these. And let me name this up. Get the images. No. That's not nice. Maybe there are too many. Let's try with this one. Down. If we were able to break this, this is fantastic. Okay. We definitely sent way more images than this thing can process, which I think it's another reason why we're breaking records. Let me just select some of them then. We'll just select, these. See if it works. All right, seems like it is working. Because I can't really press any button. No, it's not working. Okay, I'll select. It was working with like 10 of them, so. Let me select none of them. Well, this is quite weird. Refresh the page. All right, let's try again. If it doesn't work, then I will show it to you anyway with some photos that I uploaded before. So up, let's try to select all of them. See what happens. No, doesn't like them. Okay. All right, this is quite, it's not really nice. Anyway, I will be selecting only some of them. I mean, five worked before, so if it doesn't work now, I don't know. Okay, loading sample, fantastic. Let's see. Okay, we have five. Let's see if we can use a little more than five. That would be a little more interesting. But anyway, you can go ahead and use this data set to try it at home, right? So if you wanna then come to us and say like, hey, this worked on my local machine by implementing this model, this other model, then that's actually great. Like if one of you or some of you wants to go ahead and do all of this, I mean, that would be fantastic. Okay, let's go ahead and choose a couple more. No, yes, fantastic. All right, then let's do the same for the down. Let's try to. All right, bear with us. We're almost getting there. Okay, now these should be enough. Let's see if it uploads them. Fantastic. Okay. You see people really did a great effort. And if you see your thumb here, then you're lucky. Right, let's try to train the model with this and hope that it works, even though I have some doubts since there's a bunch of noise, but we can try and see how it performs. Okay. Right, so it's training, it shouldn't take that long. Otherwise, we'll just try it out with a couple of images that I prepared before. Yeah, it's probably too complex for the machine. So, I mean, wasn't really able to prepare this beforehand as I didn't have your hands, but we tried anyway. Yes, I did not rename the classes, but we'll get class one. Oh, it is training indeed. Fantastic. So we'll still get class one and class two. I don't really want to break this right now. Okay, so you're seeing how it's training. And you can go ahead and try this by yourself, right? If you want to experiment with it. Okay, now let's try to turn on the webcam. Hopefully it works. I tried this before and you have to play with it a little bit. Turned off, let's... Come on. Okay, let's see if it's working. I was having some issues also before. Let me try to turn off my webcam here in the chat. Oops. Sorry about this wrong button. So please work. So if I now put my hand like this, let's see what it recognizes. All right, it seems like it's working. See? And of course it will never be 100%. Right? It's quite weird because we're dealing with a machine learning problem, not with a rules-based approach, right? Well, let's try to do this and see what it outputs. Right? Fantastic. Let's try this. And okay, so why do you think it's predicting this to be down? Why do you think it's predicting my thumbs up to be a down? And in the meantime, I'll be showing you how to export the model. So again, Mario is saying because of the palm back of the hand, and that is totally correct. Indeed, that is what I was explaining before, right? So as you have seen, the features captured by our classifier are not only the position of the thumb, so if it's upwards or downwards, right? So if we have, let's say, some sort of object with another object below or above, right? It's also capturing the features of the fingers and of the back of the hand, right? So this is truly important to understand, right? As you may see, us humans would definitely say, well, it's really easy to understand that the two classes are thumbs up and thumbs down, but that's not the case for a neural network. So as you may see, and you can try this by yourself, so please go ahead and do this. If you use different orientations of your hand, right? If you try also to stick to the same background so as to reduce noise, then you will be able to get better results. As you see right now, in the what is it? Okay, it's not really predicting anything, right? It kind of goes between class one and class two because it's not really it's capable of capturing any features. It just randomly goes between one and two, right? And that's what we were also saying before. Anyway, let me also show you quite quickly, and that will close off our session, but bear with us for the description of the project because that's the most important thing, of course. You can also upload your model, right? So you can share it with others. And if you wish, I'll be sharing the model with you right now. So let's just, yes, here it is. So let me copy this link and paste it in the chat, and the core team can forward it in the various channels. Oops, I didn't mean to close this. And so you can see the actual code of the model, which is not as complex as one may believe. Right, so if you go to TensorFlow, there's a Python implementation of the model. Yes, here it is. In particular, we're using Keras, which is part of TensorFlow, and it's used for neural networks. Here it is. So as you may see, it is not complex at all, as I was also saying before. And this is simply the model, right? So you use a lot of libraries that are already implemented for you. You don't really have to do much. The only thing that you have to do is to understand the amount of neurons the kind of problem that you're dealing with, the depth of your network, and all of this. So it might seem easy, but as you've seen in the previous exercise, it is very hard. It's not easy at all right? So that's why what happens usually, let me close this. Let's go back to our presentation. So the idea was actually to try to confuse the machine, right? And we were actually able to do so by just using the thumbs up, but in the other, or with the other orientation, right? So what usually happens with neural network engineers is that, you know, we are not really good at feature selection. We're not really good at understanding how many layers we want, how many neurons we want, what the right activation functions are. So we just try them all and see whenever the network performs well. And that actually happens in reality, and you might also get a nice result, right? But you might perhaps not be able to justify why the procedure is sound. And for certain cases, that's also totally fine. I mean, as long as you have what you need, you might be happy with it, right? But trust me, it takes a lot of time to truly understand the essence of neural networks, right? I'm totally not there yet, and also very skilled machine learning engineers are not there yet. There's a lot to learn, a lot of courses, a lot of theory, so please don't think that it's very easy. It is actually not, okay? So I think this brings us to the review, the final review of what we did today. And again, do not leave, because we have the project description coming up, and that is truly important. I'm looking forward to hear from you next time. I really would like only to provide a lot of feedback, but really, I'm really looking forward to your projects, to be honest. All right. And there's a lot to learn, Butterbean, both for humans and for computers, of course. And there's also a lot of other learning approaches, such as meta-learning or reinforcement learning, right? And those are fascinating, but there's a lot to know. Anyway, so today, what did we do? First off, we connected. That's the most important thing, right? We were here. We were talking together. We tried to do this in the most interactive way as possible. So thanks a lot, because you made this another fantastic experience. And really, I cannot wait for Monday. And so besides that, we also learned what a neural network is, right? We watched a video, which was quite interesting, about cats and dogs, right? Then we also understood the basics, right, around the neural network. So the features, the neurons, how the neurons are connected, and all of that. We also understood when a network is useful, and the answer to that is when the problem that you're facing is very complex. So when the problem is not as easy as, okay, I have to distinguish, I don't know, also numbers. If you think about numbers, you can use a neural network for that. But you can also use regular computer vision techniques, which identify the features, right? But when you want to identify numbers that are written by children, for instance, or actually also by us, we don't all write the same, then you definitely want to go for a neural network, right? All right, so it's useful when the problem is quite complex. And we have simple models and complex models, and we need to be aware when one is better and when the other is better, right? We have seen the difference between machine learning and deep learning, but we've also seen a very important concept, that is that of overfitting and underfitting, right? So make sure to do none of those two, or no overfitting, no underfitting. And the limitation of neural network, of course, and also machine learning in general, is of course the data, right? If you throw in garbage, then you will get out garbage from your network. So please make sure every time you do a machine learning task that your data is clean. So yeah, I guess we're quite done for today. And by the way, I do not have Instagram, but I'm sure you guys all connected through this fantastic popular social network. I'll leave it to Alejandro, who will introduce the project, and then I will be connecting again to dive deeper into the description of the task specifically. So off to you, Alejandro.
Thank you, Jacopo. I mean, first of all, I just want to thank you for all the content that you presented and the way you've done it. All these activities, not only were they useful, but also really fun. This last one was definitely very entertaining. In any case, let me start sharing the screen, because everything that Jacopo has presented throughout these 2 days now reaches a point where it is up to you to put it, you know, together and come up with a nice idea. And that's what the project is about. So I'm going to share my screen now. And there we go. You should be seeing this presentation now, which is what we would have done if we had been in person. Right here, but fortunately we cannot be doing this kind of activity, everyone, you know, like in a classroom, due to the current conditions and the current situation. So that didn't stop us from putting together this nice activity. We just modified it a little bit. Main goals stay the same: identify a potential machine learning application and synthesize what you have learned to create an ML project pitch. That's important. Just a project pitch. You will not actually be building anything too complex at this point, because this is the, you know, the beginner's track. Maybe later on we can focus on something more complex and more hands-on. But it should start with visual thinking, and this would be like something that'd be really interesting to do in person, as I mentioned. But it's something that if you create a group with anybody that's currently here or later on, whenever you decide to start working on the project, you can do somehow, maybe on Google Meets, or, you know, there are plenty of ways to share stuff and communicate with others these days. But this is one of the main activities that we would be doing. So it's interesting that everyone's aware of it. Obviously, we're not gonna be walking around and reviewing your notes, but this would be really fun to do in person, as I'm saying. Also, this cannot be done right now, but this is important. You need to propose an idea for an application of ML. So these things that are listed here, you need to be aware of it, and obviously, you know, decide which one is more fitting. So I'm just gonna run through these slides, because obviously they don't apply perfectly to what we're going to be doing this time, but it is important for everyone to be aware of the final goals and the spirit of this specific project, right? So this part would be the last, actually, and this is what we're actually going to be doing. You guys will be presenting your ideas on Monday, but not everyone, because there are many of you, and we're expecting many project submissions. So obviously it would be a really, really long event. And even though we would love to host such a long event, maybe it's too much. So what we are trying to do is, we know we mentioned it'd be just 3 winners, but possibly there'll be more of you, just depending on the number of submitted projects. But in any case, the best ones will be presenting their projects. So best groups will be presenting their project ideas in a pitch manner on Monday, and we'll record it, and everything will be uploaded on our YouTube channel. So this stuff will be for us forever. So it is a really interesting activity. And let me move on to the, you know, the actual instructions for this time around, since everyone's online and we still need to review your projects and be aware of what you've done. So, 1 second, I will put this here, right there. Okay, so Jacopo crafted this stuff very nicely for us to have clear instructions on how to proceed if you're interested in participating on this project. So the first thing, you'll need to create a folder on Google Drive, and this is the name. By the way, don't worry about like all the specific stuff. You don't need to be taking any screenshots right now. We'll be sharing these documents on our Telegram. And if you're not on Telegram yet, I definitely suggest you to join us there. But if not, you can always reach out to us through email or other social media platforms, and we'll make sure we get this document to you. But just moving on, the second one would be to save a copy of the template, which I also have ready here. This is for us to actually, this is the questions. This one. There we go. There we go. So this is the template that you'll need to follow. And obviously with the task that Jacopo will present and describe, it'll make more sense. But this will also be provided to everyone who wants to participate. So you need to save that copy, and then you'll have to fill it out. 2-page max and appendix with any, you know, like pictures or maybe some other important information that is not part of the actual main 2 pages, right? And then create and upload the slides following the template below. And this is very important. Only once you're done, you can submit your project. You'll have to share with us the folder, both with DSC PoliMi and with Jacopo. So that way we can access your Google Drive. But please, please do not share your folder, your Google Drive, before it's done. Because the moment it's done, for us, the moment it's shared, for us, it means that it's done. And we'll check the time it's been shared and the last time any of the documents have been modified, because that will affect maybe bonus points, as you can see here under deadlines. We are going to be sort of rewarding those projects that are submitted earlier. And so if you submit them before Saturday, this Saturday, November 21st, before 8 p.m., you'll get a super bonus, which has a specific amount of points. And if you do so before Saturday midnight, you'll still get some bonuses. Otherwise, you need to make sure that you submit them before noon on Sunday, November the 22nd. And that's just the standard submission. You won't get any points, but you'll still be able to participate in this sort of project contest. And you'll be reviewed for you know, a place on the event on Monday. So this would be all of it in terms of the instructions. You can take a look at it while I'm sharing my screen, but don't worry too much about it. We're going to be sharing all these documents once the event is over. Also, this event has been recorded, and we're going to post it on YouTube for those who weren't able to attend it live, and they're still interested in participating in this project. So with that being said, I think Jacopo can actually explain the details of the task, which is the crucial part of the project. So, Jacopo, back to you.
All right. Thank you. I'll be sharing my screen again. And thank you so much for bearing with us, even though it's kind of late. So I'm really sure that if you're here, it means that you're very interested. So that is fantastic, simply fantastic. And also, let me mention that these are group projects. So you're required to be in a group of at least two people and maximum 4 people, right? So again, if you do not have found a person to do this project with and you're very interested in doing that, please just randomly pick somebody from all of the Instagram and LinkedIn links that we have, or ask for help to the core team, or just ask on the Telegram chat, right? And say, I'm looking for somebody. I can do this, I can do that. But in reality, for this project, you won't really be needing any technical coding expertise, or you will just be needing what we have been saying in these two sessions, right? So if you, again, please go ahead and reach out to somebody. Hey, do you want to do the project together? And you never know, you might be meeting what would be a very good friend of you from now on. So anyway, let's jump into the task. So the task is the following. The first thing that you have to do is to choose one topic between the following: the experience at Politecnico di Milano, which includes, like, I don't know, studying at Politecnico di Milano, or I don't know, like wandering around Politecnico di Milano, the classrooms at Politecnico di Milano, whatever is related to Politecnico di Milano, right? Could be also something around the website, right? So anything. The second topic is regarding COVID-19, of course, because why not? And it is regarding the possibility of connecting with friends and colleagues during the lockdown phase. Is this Inferno Dantesco? No, where are you? The chat is starting to, it's starting to get late, you're right. Anyway, so you kind of want to focus on the second topic about connecting with friends and colleagues during a lockdown phase. So I don't know, you may imagine like a mobile application or a web application or any other sort of game or application where ML is leveraged. So of course this all relates to machine learning, right? Okay, so then you want to identify a real world scenario, right, that relates to your chosen topic. So it could be, I don't know, people walking throughout Politecnico di Milano, right? All right, and you also want to identify a specific problem that you wish to address, and also the reason why it is important, relevant to students, to the users that you're considering, right? You can also do something that involves professors or the I don't know, the staff at Politecnico, right? Or our club, right? I'm throwing out like a lot of ideas so you can understand what we're referring to. So then you want to review the existing ways that there are to solve the identified problem. So let's make an example. If you want to, if you're considering the problem of, I don't know, measuring the number of students at Politecnico di Milano for a certain days, for a certain day, then you might say, well, there are only estimations, right? You may ask Politecnico di Milano staff if that is put into place, or you may come up with ideas, or you may say, well, there are the how are they called, like turnstiles, I don't really remember the word for that, the tornelli, right, that at like in the architecture building. So just review the ways to solve the problems, if there are any, right? And they can also be non-machine learning or non-computer science related. They could also be just ways to solve the problem that you identified. And if there are no existing solutions to the problem, just try to go ahead and identify possible reasons why there are no solutions, right? So for instance, like it costs too much to solve this, there's no time to solve this issue, or for instance, like nobody really cares about this, right? All right, so do either identify existing ways to solve the problems, or identify possible reasons why you can't really solve the problem, right? Okay, let's move on. So then you want to define a precise problem statement, and this is crucial, right? Both the problem statement and the goal, let me make them bold, are very important for you to identify, right? There are one or two sentences on what is the problem and one or two sentences on what is your goal. Then you want to brainstorm ideas around possible solutions leveraging at least one machine learning technique, right? So we have seen regression classification and blah, blah, blah. And you can also go on the web and search for other techniques. So come up with ideas that leverage at least one of these. But please do not make it complex, because there's no point into using like all of the methods, right? Probably one will be enough, but you must use one, right? Because otherwise it wouldn't be machine learning related. So and therefore come up with a solution, right? just an idea. We do not want any code. We do not want any demo, right? We just want the idea. So be able to visualize it, to explain it, right? Right. And also, make sure you write down your assumptions. For instance, like you assume that you have the data on the number of students who entered, I don't know, Edificio 1, right? Building 1 or whatever. And also motivate them, right? So why are you making those assumptions? So why are you assuming that you have like a lot of money for this task? For instance, I don't know, we plan to obtain a grant from the Italian Ministry of whatever, right? Digital innovation. And finally, it is very important to identify which possible data sources you will be using, right? And also if you will be using any services, any pre-trained models, or whatever else, right? And you also want to identify the pros and cons of the solution, not only from a technical point of view, but also socially and ethically, right? Because for instance, is it ethical to, I don't know, leverage the data that might be quite private, right? So you want to make sure that you dive deep into that. And also make sure to include possible trade-offs. For instance, like you really like your model to be accurate, however, you will be giving up on the speed of the prediction, right? So I know that you're quite new to machine learning and all of that, but try to think about it. Like, we will not be evaluating how correct it is, but we will be evaluating your thought, your originality in the idea, the effort that you put in doing everything, right? Of course, if it doesn't make sense, then it doesn't make sense, but we won't be penalizing for things that are very like that are very off, let's say, right? So please make a big effort to do that. So to summarize what you will have to do practically, for you will have to output two resources that are going to be Google Docs, right? Which is simply this document, maximum 2 pages long, plus appendix, and again, in the with no images, the appendix is done exactly for that purpose, right? So we want maximum 2 pages with no images, so only text, and it must respect the font, the template, and everything else, right? So this, just copy this and copy and paste this, and you will be good. There's further explanation here. And to finish this up, also include any reference that you use, so website, books, scientific papers, and all that. And then you can also use the appendix, which is, again, 2 pages maximum. We're not looking for a lot of images. We don't really care about that. But please include some nice visuals if you wish, or technical details to further explain a certain technique, right? If you want to dive deeper into something, then sure. But make sure that one person is able to understand your solution and your ideas only by reading the project report. Regarding the slides, all of you are quite invited, and it's part of the also evaluation to select the best projects that will be presenting on Monday to produce some slides. And also the slides template is fixed, so please bear with this, because it is quite important. And we're also doing this in order to try to convey you a good practice over slides and presentations, right? Your presentations will be around 5 to 8 minutes, and so you don't want like a lot of slides. And so you do not want to have a lot of text. Definitely don't want that, because we already have the Google Doc, right? We don't need text. We just need images, bullet points, right? Just some keywords. And they're only a support for your presentation, so we don't need them. Style is important, but the content and message is more. We are aware that you don't really have a lot of time, and we have even less to evaluate them, so don't really bother much about the style. Of course, it is still important, but the content and the message that you're conveying is more important. And of course, if your project is chosen among the best ones, and we will see how many there are, at least three. You'll be asked to present on November the 23rd, right? And the presentations must be from 5 to 8 minutes maximum, not more than 8 minutes. And we will be also having this interactive session in which other students will be asking you questions, providing you feedback, and you will receive feedback also from myself. So I think it's a really great opportunity. It's probably the meeting that I would be most looking forward to. And then the slide template is this one, so you can go ahead and read it by yourself. There are 7 slides in which the first one is just the title and the team name and team members' information. And that's really important. And the last one is about conclusions. So yeah, you can then go ahead and read it. And for any questions, you can just contact us. So yeah, I guess that's pretty much it. And I'll leave it to Alejandro for a for final remarks. And again, from my side, thank you so much for bearing with us all of this time. I mean, this was incredible. And I know that there are a lot of questions that were not answered, and I'll do my best to go ahead and answer them in the following days, the following weeks, because you know it's not easy to answer all of them. Some of them are also quite complex, so you know how to reach out to me anytime. So please do it if you want to dive deeper into something, if you want any sort of advice. And yeah, we'll just talk again on Monday, and in the meantime, good luck with your project.
Okay, thanks, Jacopo. Just one little thing that I want to add that I didn't mention at the beginning of the details. The winners will actually get a t-shirt, the same one or maybe different ones on different colors as Jacopo is wearing right now. We have actually kept safe in Rome right now. That's where Simone, our core team member, has them, and one way or another we'll get them to you. But yeah, exactly. Jacopo is adding that there. And as we said, these documents will be shared with everyone, either through Telegram or any other social media. So don't be worried if you didn't get everything. And we're always here for you to ask any questions if you have any doubts. Also, I saw one important question on the chat and I wanted to clarify it. Yes, all the presentations should be in English, since this is an international program and we are aware that there are many people here that go to PoliMi. Maybe they are not even PoliMi, but they come from different countries. For example, I'm from Spain. We saw the other day there are people from Brazil, many places here in Europe. So we'll try to keep it everything in English. And plus, all this material is going to be posted on YouTube. So later on, many more people may actually watch it. So just that one, what is the max number of people in a group? We said 2 to 4 people. That'd be ideal, since it's an activity that will require everyone to participate. And if we make it individual, it's not beneficial for that specific person. If we allow for too many members, maybe some slack off and don't actually participate actively, and the others just carry all the weight. But other than that, as I said, we'll share all these things. And I just wanted to thank Jacopo once again. All these presentations were amazing. This was a unique opportunity for everyone to learn machine learning outside of the university context, but peer-to-peer with other students that may be interested in it. And hopefully we did it in a dynamic and fun way. And so we'll be here until Sunday for all your questions and stuff. And then on Sunday, we'll review all the projects. On Monday, we'll have this amazing showcase event with the winners. So hopefully everyone enjoyed it, and it's getting late. So everyone goes to eat dinner or something, and we'll be, but they have finished. Okay, I was just like reading a few of the questions. In any case, thank you all for being here. We really appreciate your time. And till next time.
Bye-bye.
Bye.